This is Radio Scotland FM. 25 years ago today, writer and naturalist Gavin Maxwell died in an Inverness hospital. He's best remembered for his book Ring of Bright Water, which told the story of life with his otters at Sandaig, a remote bay near the west coast village of Glenelg. His search for a simple life captured the imagination of millions of people worldwide. Now, for the first time in 25 years, his close friends returned to Sandaig, the place he regarded as his spiritual home. Ian Thompson joins them for a remarkable reunion.
Well, I made it, Terry.
Yeah, you made it. Good walk.
Lindy, is this the old track we're on?
This is the old track. This is right. The track that we used to drive up with our jeeps and motorbikes and walk up sometimes as well. Mm-hmm. Can I introduce you to all these people?
Please.
Okay, Magda Sterling. Ian.
How do you do?
Jimmy Watts.
Jimmy.
Hi, Ian.
Richard Freyr.
Hi, Ian. Ian.
Hello, bye.
Hello.
Pylon. Jimmy's dog. And, of course, the midges.
Aye, we're all scratching a little.
Quite a few midges around today. But we've still got to go a little way yet. The steepest bit.
Right.
Put some marks down there.
Hundreds of people a year still come down to seek out this hidden place. But there's little left to see of what Maxwell knew. In 1968, his home was burnt to the ground. Only two large boulders remain. One where his otter Idle is buried, and the other where his own ashes were scattered a day 25 years ago. And if those years had passed since his close friends were gathered together here at Sandaig, Jimmy Watt and Teddy Napkins were boys when they first came here as otter keepers. Richard Freyr, his long-suffering business manager, if you like. Douglas Spotting, his friend and biographer. His cousin Magda Sterling and the local boys, Willie MacLeod and Alan McDermott. And I can tell you, they helped Maxwell through many a dilemma. He wasn't a practical man. We're heading down to the tiny whitewashed cottage of his long friend, Rafe Payne. Just a stone's throw from where Gavin created his own Ring of Bright Water. But as Terry pointed out as we began our descent, there's been many changes in this place since those early days.
Standing here, looking across to the islands, the first thing I noticed is the severe lack of seabirds. None there at all. It used to be white. The main island, the lighthouse island, used to be white with seabirds. Black-backed gulls, common gulls, terns, everything. And when we walked on there in the spring, you really had to watch where you were stepping because you could step on the bird very easily, sitting on the nest. But nothing at all now. That's the first change, really, for me.
Mm.
What about for you, Jimmy?
What about you, Jimmy?
Well, getting back to the gulls, there were so many gulls there that we used to collect the eggs for the otters. Used to make huge omelettes.
Otter omelettes.
It took a bit of sort of stealing to do it sometimes. You know, a great pan full of small gull chicks.
But what we've got to say is that we only stole the blackback eggs.
Yes. And only one from the nest, and they always laid again.
Mm-hmm.
But it supplemented the food supply marvellously for the otters, and they loved it.
And us.
Sometimes.
But on this old track, Richard, it must have been difficult to get up and down.
Oh, very difficult, yes. Yes. Even in the best conditions, it was hard, but if it rained and or anything went wrong, or the mud running down it, one had to winch oneself up very often. Hence the lack of some of these trees one feels, because they're very small when I started to use the Land Rover here. And I used to pull them over, used to snap over, and each time you took a grip with your winch cable. And then you'd move the winch cable up to the next tree, pull that down too. Very, very hard going. Very slow.
When did you come down here, Magda?
It was about 1960. I was about 15. I came with my mother, which was quite an experience. It started with getting stuck. And I think it ended roughly the same way.
Mm-hmm.
It's very strange being back. I mean, it's a real... the last 24 hours have been very weird.
Yeah.
It's very odd to sort of slip back all that time.
You're back in time.
Yeah.
And this is the first time you've all been together again since Gavin Maxwell's death.
Yes.
Yeah, and there's two people that I haven't seen for quite a few years. One is Douglas Botting. I haven't seen Douglas, I don't think, for 20 years, maybe more. And Rafe I haven't seen for probably 4 or 5 years.
They're down at the Croft.
They're down at the Croft, and it's the first time we've all ever been together as a group, so it's going to be quite an interesting reunion, really. Get a word out, reunion.
I haven't seen Jimmy since the night before the fire.
Really? There's a window opening in the sky. What about going down to the Croft and seeing how they...
Might be a couple of wages, but...
Or something stronger. A bit early for that.
Yes, I do. Yeah, I remember. Yeah, clearly walking down the hill and with Gavin, and first seeing the bay and the house.
Oh, yes.
It was incredibly exciting thing to for a young boy to be able to do.
How did Gavin Maxwell come on this place?
It was through knowing Lord Dalton, who owned this estate. They were in the army together. And then after Gavin had finished doing with the shark fishing exploits on the Isle of Soy in 1946-47, he wanted to have a place up in the Highlands, because he'd grown to love it then, and Lord Dalton had sand egg available, so that was how Gavin originally came here. So that was the late 40s when he came.
Uh-huh.
Mm. And this is wonderful, isn't it, when you get to this point here. High tide, of course, today. And, I mean, there it is. You can see right the way down the Sound of Sleet here.
Yeah.
A bit of sunlight down there as well. And over to the right here, you've got the area where Sandegg House stood. Can you see where the stone is?
Yeah.
Well, Gavin's ashes are beneath that stone because that's where his study was. You can see it now.
Yeah.
You can still see the house now.
Yeah. But not a vestige of it other than the large stone.
Just a large stone.
I think sure.
No. You may find it one of the odd bits of wall around the place, but that's about it. It was all buried after the house was burned. For safety reasons, really, because it was totally unsafe. And there, of course, is Rafe and Douglas and Alan giving us a
big reunion.
Yeah. Taking a long route round, really.
Yeah.
And that cottage hasn't changed at all, apart from the fact that it's been whitewashed.
Very smart.
But other than that, it hasn't changed. And when you go inside, it will take you back 25, 30 years, because there's nothing been done to it at all. It's just as nature intended, fish boxes, which you can't find. Rafe! I'm very well. Lovely to see you.
How nice to see you. You're looking well.
And
Douglas.
Yes, Terry, how are you doing?
Okay.
Long time no see.
Well, many years,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, you're looking well.
Well, thank you. Yeah, and you are, too.
Oh, well, it makes a change.
Yeah. And Alan?
Yeah.
Douglas?
Hi.
Ian Thompson.
Yeah.
Very pleased to meet you this morning.
One little tame girl we met.
Hi, Douglas. Richard. Hello. Good seeing you.
Yeah.
Do you arrive last night?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, we had breakfast, then we had lunch, you know. I mean, we're expecting you a little earlier in the day. We're thinking about having tea.
Right, okay.
This must be the occasion when I come across the doorstep with a bottle. And would you all care for a dram?
Yes, please.
You're not a man.
You're very welcome.
Magda.
Good to have you all here. And
Terry,
if you've got the jam, Terry, let's have a toast then to Gavin and many happy memories here at Sandy.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah.
And to Gavin.
To Gavin.
Willie, although you were a child when Gavin came here first of all, you would remember him.
Oh, yes. I remember up to the day he arrived. He came running, came along in this beautiful Bentley, open Bentley, racing Bentley car. And basically from then, we got to know him, and what do I say?
Was he good to you as a kid?
Oh, yes.
Was he kind
to
you?
Very, very good, yes. Uh-huh. He asked us, would we take his mail down to him, so... This was a ritual we did every night. And sometimes it could be quite a lot. Mm. 5 gallons of paraffin and about 10 parcels of books and various mail. It used to be a heavy load.
Were you in his car at all?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, many, many, many times. Uh-huh. Any time he was going to Kyle, which he went quite often for shopping, cigarettes and other things. And he always stopped at Tormore and asked my parents would be all right if the children went for a run, because he knew how much we loved getting in the car. And
what an oldie.
It was. It's fantastic. Yeah.
And did you learn something about driving?
I did, yes. I learned to drive with his car. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. Uh-huh. Quite a lot of time he didn't know about it. But.
And how did he cope with a single track?
No bother at all.
That way.
No bother. Very good driver, yeah. Uh-huh. Marvellous man, yes. Lovely to have this day to think back and happy memories.
How did you find him, Alan? You worked with him quite a lot when he was first at Sandy.
Well, first impressions, of course, being Highland, born and bred in the place, you're always a bit suspicious of a stranger coming into it. And we know all the white settlers, you know, we call them. Mm-hmm. Live in the place. So I suppose I thought then, you know, what's he coming into here, you know, this place. But then I had a great relationship with him, you know, who were working for him here. He knew what he wanted, like, and I suppose he got it.
Jimmy, you were the first of his Arta keepers. How did he come across you? I mean, where did you appear from?
I appeared from school. I left school, and he came to interview me for a job.
What was your first impressions of Gavin Maxwell? Did he overawe you, or did he...
No, he tried to make me relax. I can remember being interviewed with... I was in my headmaster's study, and the headmaster there, Gavin, was there, and I was there. And I was very nervous, of course, and Gavin said, "Oh, Jimmy, just put your hands in your pockets." And my headmaster turned to Gavin and said, "Our boy's pockets are sewn up." So I was even more flustered. But I mean, that was his first thing, was to try to make one relax and try to be friendly, Very generous spirit, always.
Really? Mm. He had a military background, and therefore he expected a certain amount of discipline. And
yes, but he was a very well-disciplined man himself.
Was he?
Had great self-discipline, especially when with his writing. He'd give himself, you know, duty every day to say, "Well, I've got to do 2,000 words, and I'm not going to stop to that." So in the good weather, he'd go up to the waterfall, which is where he felt the soul of Sandhay was, and he'd lie up there with the sound of the waterfall and surrounded by the flowers and the honeysuckle, and he'd lie there with his book and his pens and just do it. And Terry and I would go up and feed him coffee or whiskey or food or whatever was appropriate at the time.
But when he first came here, of course, the house was very, very primitive.
Well, yes, it was oil lamps, tillies, two primer stoves, and an open fire, and that was it. And a few sticks of furniture made of firewood, and a marvellous chair that Rafe had made out of barrel staves, which was superbly comfortable. But at the beginning, there was no water in the house, no electricity, no telephone, and they were good days. And we grew to love that. And the hiss of the tilly lamps at night, it's always company and warm and with a dram, and you know, it was good times. Good people came.
Mm-hmm. And then you came across Terry, of course.
Absolutely, yeah. And in 1959, from a totally different world, really, a sort of concrete jungle, which London was at the time. But my interest in animals started when I was 8 years old, and I didn't like school at all. And one day I decided to cross the vast expanse of green grass called Regent's Park and climb over the fence and land up with the elephants at the zoo. And then Gavin wrote to London Zoo, or telephoned London Zoo, and asked if they knew of anyone at all that would like to come to Scotland and look after a new otter called Teco. And off I went. I went on that overnight train, and Gavin met me at Kyle. And all I saw was this man waiting on the platform with a kilt, and I'd never seen a man in a kilt before. So it was all wonderful for me to see these things.
Was he difficult in the sense that here you were a young kid that had to do what you were told? Did he come heavy on you in that sense?
He came heavy on us once we got things like the telephone in the house. I mean, Gavin treated the telephone as an intrusion as well sometimes. Other times he liked the telephone, but if he was working, if he was writing, and we were making too much noise, now and again we sort of played a few loud records, but not that often. He would tell us, put us in our place, really.
Yeah, exactly.
Quite rightly so. Yeah. Because he was bringing the money into the household and had to do all the work. Mm-hmm. And it was hard work when you got demands from publishers to write reviews and also write other books as well, of course, mm-hmm. after the success of Ring of Bright Water.
Mm-hmm. You read the proofs of Ring of Bright Water?
I did. In fact, I read them. I read the manuscript as he was writing it. I came up here actually to make a short television film of his second daughter Edel, during the time that he was getting towards the end of Ring of Bright Water. And every evening hour he'd come back from the waterfall or wherever he was writing it and give it to me to read and said, "What do you think of that?" And fortunately he didn't follow my advice. I mean, I thought this was a fascinating subject, but terribly badly written. mainly because it fell into two halves. One was a wonderful idyll about living here in the Ring of Bright Water place, and that I thought was marvellous. And then suddenly it seemed to lunge into a totally different story of the story of two otters. Also delightful. And I said, well, because I was studying English literature at university at the time, and I was full of all these sort of crackpot theories about what writing books was about, that he should rewrite the whole thing, sit down and begin all over again, and merge the otters and the saga of Ring of Bright Water. So he just poured another very long whiskey and looked over the glass at me and said, OK, chum, anything you say, chum, and totally disregarded my advice. But what I did think was that actually it was a wonderful sort of kind of utopian idyll in the making, you know, and obviously when it was published and the sales figures soared, then he was proved right and I was proved wrong. I think that really a book like Ring of Bright Water and many of his books were really the works of a poet, that is, who handled language like a poet, but looked at the world like a painter. And that's why I think they had such a big impact on people.
Really?
Because quite a lot of people have written about lives with animals in remote places, like Sandegg. But very few of those books have had the impact of Ring of Bright Water.
He didn't write it to be a successful book.
Mm.
He wrote it because of his feelings about the place, and of course it did become a successful book, and being a successful book then brought in all the problems that go with success.
Sure.
Money, for example,
yeah.
That comes in, and of course you then have demands from other areas, and you get things like telephone, electricity, and then intermixed with that you've got the problems with the otters. It didn't help any at all.
And do you regret the fact that the place changed from the simplicity you came to what it developed into from years?
I do now. I do now. I don't think I even thought of it at the time. But yes, I do now. When you're a kid, these things happen, and you take it in your stride. But now, when I look back, there are many times when, if I was a wiser and an older person, I could have quite honestly sat down and spoke to Gavin and discussed those problems. But obviously, I wasn't capable at that age of doing it, or wasn't aware that I was able to do it.
Where sun and wind play on a ring bright water, that's where my heartland will be. The deer on the hill.
Of course, after the success of Ring of Bright Water, the film industry got deep into it.
How did Gavin react to that?
First of all, he went along with it, but then when he found the sort of film they were making, he wasn't happy with it. In fact, he didn't go to the premiere, which was in Leicester Square.
Sort of film? How do you mean, Jimmy?
Well, it was a romantic love story, really.
Right.
And it had not much bearing on the truth of what really happened here.
None whatsoever, really.
So the general public got a fairly false view of...
Well, if that was all they'd heard of or seen that film, certainly. Yes.
Well, you're absolutely right there. People this day still think that the Ring of Bright Water film was the true story of Ring of Bright Water.
Mm.
We get many comments about that. It was on quite recently, and people said, oh, what a wonderful film Ring of Bright Water is. What a wonderful story. But it's frustrating, really, when you know it wasn't the true story.
Did Gavin have regrets about the film and regrets about the fact that the place itself had changed?
I definitely had regrets about the place changing.
Had he?
I think so. I mean, we had terrible intrusions in that we didn't, in the early days, we didn't have a loo in the house at all. And once Ring of Bright Water was published, people used to come up on top of the hill with binoculars and take a good look, if that's what pleased them, but they did.
Yeah.
And people just turning up, banging on the door, saying, we've come to see you, and we've travelled miles and miles to see you.
It's a very difficult anomaly, isn't it, this business of being famous and yet not wanting fame.
Well, it is, yeah. But, and at the end of the day, Gavin never, ever thought that he would be a famous person.
Did he not?
No, he didn't want to be a famous person. As I said earlier, Ring of Bright Water was a book written because he wanted to write about the place he loved dearly and the otters and his general lifestyle.
So it was an outpouring of his love for this place?
Oh, I think so, yeah. I mean, that's my personal opinion of it, and knowing Gavin as I knew him and discussions we had.
And his great respect for the Highland people that...
For the Highland people and for the Highland wildlife as well. He was, no doubt about it, a great wildlife man of his time, and indeed of our time now, because I don't think the otter would have been respected or protected if Gavin hadn't written Ring of Bright Water, really.
For Magda Stirling, time spent with her cousin Gavin meant a lot of fun and laughter. But even at a young age, she was aware of his darker moods. And in particular, his difficult relationship with women.
I think I was aware that Gavin was bisexual right from the beginning. I mean, I think I always knew that Gavin liked both men and women because he was somebody who desperately needed attention, and the attention came from where it did, and that's something I actually understand. And it made him, in a way, much less of a threat, if you like, and a little more removed in a funny way, because he was sort of slightly from another planet, and that was quite fun, quite interesting.
What was the importance of this place to you?
It was my first grown-up trip away from home. It was a trip into a completely different world. And although I grew up in the country and I knew a lot of wild places, I didn't know sea at all. And that was extraordinarily important. And I didn't know intimate grown-up conversation. He was immensely kind, and I think that showed in his treatment of us as children, and in the way that he would bring in anybody who looked as if they were left out or whatever. It was part of his upbringing and training, I think, but it was also partly to do with something inside, which is, I think, he was very abandoned in some way, and so he identify very strongly with anything or anyone that was abandoned or in trouble. He wasn't a tremendously happy man. What he was an unhappy man with wonderful moments of joy. And, you know, if you were there when he had his upsurges, he was clever, he was funny. One thing led to another and another and another, and it was wonderful kind of lateral thinking off in every direction. And it was very exciting to be with. And that sort of tremendous gentleness as well, which is the bit that he writes from, the inner thing, the inner ring of bright water. I think that's the boy naturalist, yes. Because he was.
But, of course, tragedy struck with the fire at the house at Sandick. You were here, of course.
Yes, I was. Gavin was, for the most part, in very good form. And then, sort of, I don't know, the second night or the third night, he was drinking quite a lot, which he sometimes did. And sometimes he would go into very, very, very black things when he was drinking, because he'd suddenly see all the problems at once and not to be able to deal with them. And they'd lead straight on to serious metaphysical pain. Tremendous loneliness and isolation. And Gavin actually kept lighting cigarettes and sort of leaving them about in a sort of trail of sparks. And I was really nervous, actually, because it was fairly obvious that I mean, somebody had to go around behind him. Do you know what I mean? Because he really wasn't entirely as he might have been. And anyway, about 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock or whatever it was, I thought, well, I'm not going to stay up all night with Gavin stuffing out his cigarettes. So I did what is a good tradition and took him into bed, covered up his head, saved him from the foggy dew, and literally just sort of held him because he was in such a state and I didn't know what else to do. I knew I couldn't stay there. I couldn't really help. I couldn't get him out of where he was. But the only thing I could do was get him through that particular moment. It wasn't sort of remotely sexual. It was just... I don't know, humanity. And in the morning, he was fine. He was absolutely, he seemed to be fine. And I left, and it was very, you know, the last couple of hours or whatever, very jolly again. He was back in sort of really good shape and what have you. And I left, and I was away for 3 or 4 weeks, and I didn't hear about the fire until then. And when I did hear, I think this is the saddest part, actually, for me, was that when I did hear about the fire, I didn't ring him or get in touch with him, because so many things happen that you don't know at that age how to handle, you know, what to do with them or whatever. And so I never rang him. And I always feel sort of bad about that, because I didn't see him for a long time. And also, I think it was the first time I'd been in contact with serious loss, because Gavin sort of lost everything. But in a funny way, I think that maybe that Gavin needed to go and adventure elsewhere, and that he could never have left while the house stood.
Yeah. So was it a cleansing from the fire, in a sense?
I certainly don't think he would have recognised that. But I think he needed possibly to go on.
Yes.
Because I think he had reached a place of desolation. I mean, we all tell our heavens into hells. Yes.
And did he, you know, exactly, did he feel that he'd betrayed this place, that he'd...
No, because I don't think so. But, I mean, I think that he was never a very easy or a calm sort of person. But I believe what he contributed was far greater than he realised, and well, look at us all here now.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, yeah, that time yeah, on. Yeah. And there's no question that what he did was to bring this kind of awareness. I mean, everybody's dream is to go away and live a life, you know, a simple life and what have you. And he did it. And for the most part, he really succeeded, you know, and there were some wonderful times here.
Mm-hmm.
And okay, he had, you know, the bleak side, but without the bleak side, he'd never have been able to do what he did.
No, no. Well, the dogs are enjoying themselves today.
They are, aren't they? Having a good time.
They're having a great time on the beach with us.
Mm-hmm.
The tide's going back, Jimmy. Sand, stones and seaweed. This is where you used to take the otter. When you were a boy.
Every day, walk with the otters.
Did you?
With Edel, one otter.
Uh-huh.
And Terry had the other otter, Tekka, and I would go for a walk, usually about 2 hours. We used to go out, go around the rock pools and up the burn, and she'd go and fish. And had these very, very sensitive hands, and she'd go along in shallow water and put her little fingers underneath stones and put out little small fish and eels and that sort of thing, catch them.
What was the character that the otters had, you know? Were they, what sort of animals were they to work with?
In the early days, very benign and friendly, and, well, Edel used to sleep in my bed, and she used to be very warm, when she was dry, of course, she was very comfortable and cosy, and warm smelling, smelled a little malty, really. And then it was a different story at 6 o'clock in the morning when she went out for a swim to catch an eel and came back into bed. So there'd be several pints of water brought back into the bed.
And could you talk to them? Did they have a language, these animals?
Oh, yes. They had a lot of vocal noises that they...
Yeah. Wacko.
Well, that was particularly one for Tekka.
Yeah, I mean, could you tell if they were pleased or...
Yes.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. Tekka did a wacko. We called it wacko. Oh! It was like that, wasn't it? You haven't heard that. And Edel had her own sort of...
She had a questing, asking noise, which was...
That was right.
And
that's
then
it,
if she wanted something even more, you could ask her to sing. Rather like a dog begging, you could hold something out. And she'd make a sort of...
Yeah, lovely.
Long and humming, sort of one-note humming note. And that was an asking. You know, yeah. I really liked that bit of fish.
Yeah.
If you don't mind me saying so, I'm looking at your fingers.
Well, I'm doing my wow-wows.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was
unfortunately Edel, yes, but I mean, it wasn't her fault particularly. No, she'd been very ill.
Right.
And we had a friend staying with us, Caroline, came up to stay, and she was out walking with Gavin one day, and Edel took a dislike to her and just bit her in the leg, and we didn't think any more about it. And of course, a few weeks later, Caroline had given me her sweater. When she left, and a few weeks later I put it on, and she obviously related that to Caroline, and she just attacked me and bit my foot first of all, and I sort of put my hands down because it's the first time I'd ever been attacked by an animal, and I put my hands down and she grabbed hold of my finger, so it was a bit of a tug of war with her.
So they really were on the balance between being wild and domesticated, weren't they?
Well, you're dealing with complex animals, really. Yeah. Once you have an animal that is a wild animal in captivity and it's been hand-reared, it actually really doesn't quite know what it is.
Yeah.
And so you're dealing with animals which are, as I say, sort of quite complex in that way. I would always say one of the most dangerous animals is an animal that's been hand-reared but is still a wild animal.
Yeah.
Because they're unpredictable.
Yeah.
But otters are fairly in captivity. I mean, otters really... you shouldn't really keep in captivity, I don't think. I mean, it was the learning curve we all went through, and it was something that we learned at the time.
Yeah. And you don't feel there was an element of selfishness in it, that Maxwell came here to a pristine place and used it to make himself wealthy?
Oh, no. Not at all. No, no way.
It was a byproduct.
He came here because it was a place he found and a place he loved dearly, but nothing to do with making money. Money was the downfall of Sandaig, the downfall of Camusfina.
The waterfall at Sandaig was special to Maxwell. Do you feel it still is left here?
I think he felt that his soul, this is where his soul would return to after he had died. Personally speaking, I don't necessarily have that kind of vibration myself, that his soul is here. But when I first came back to Sandaig after he had died, that is some years after, I felt that the whole place was, I mean, it sounds very odd, one's a bit embarrassed to say it, but that the whole place was permeated with his spirit, and not just the waterfall. And in fact, this feeling was reinforced. I'd arrived late at night, a moonlit night, exactly the same kind of night as when I first arrived here in his company. And I'd stayed in Rafe's Croft. And when the door is shut and the curtains are pulled, it's pitch black in there. So when you open the door, it's a sort of blinding light out there in the morning. And the moment I opened the door, it was as though somebody, some kind of spirit or force or whatever, had switched something on, because instantly a brilliant little rainbow went from the burn by the bridge there to the first island. And then, as though the whole thing was orchestrated, a skein of hooper swans, about seven hooper swans, flew exactly under the arch of the rainbow, flew away, and then again the same switch, the rainbow was switched off, disappeared, vanished totally. And I thought, well, I think the old guy's still around, although he's been dead some years. Mm. A very, very strong feeling, which other people have had.
No, that's the first time I've heard that from you, and that's an interesting point, in that one evening when we were all sitting around the fire in the house, Jimmy, Gavin, myself, and I think it was James Robertson Justice at the time, it was my turn to go down to the burn here, where the bridge was, to collect the eels. And I'd done that for months on end without even thinking about it. It was a dark, dark night. Went down, picked the torch up, went down to the bridge, opened the box, started taking the eels out, and something made me look up. I shone the torch up, and there, standing on the bridge, was a man with a kilt on and all the Highland gear that you would wear, and stood there and smiled at me, and I was terrified. I dropped the eels, ran back to the house, and Gavin said, what's happened? You look like you've seen a ghost. And I said, Gavin, yes, I have seen something there, and I don't understand what it is, and it frightened me. Now, a few years back, I realized who that person was, and it was in fact Gavin.
Good heavens. Yeah.
It was
very
Gavin.
Strange.
Yeah.
And that was during his lifetime.
Yeah. Isn't that incredible? And you've just, I mean, that story you told just now was linked up to the bridge, so it must be something to do with that particular area.
It's very strong. It's very strong. And a lot of people have felt it. And I can't work out why it is. Richard knows about this as well as anybody.
I think the association with the man is very strong here, too. It still remains, even today. I mean, all this time, I've been able to sort of place him. He sort of appears to me in front of various backcloths. And I think that comes from within me rather than anything externally.
Was he a spiritual man?
Spiritual man, no.
Was he not?
I think we should remind ourselves at this stage that he said that if any part of me ever comes back, it will be to the waterfall. And I don't think he probably felt that any part of himself would come back in the mysterious. We seem to have strayed very much into the world of the paranormal, which Gavin was very sceptical about, though he was interested in it.
Yes.
And there was a sort of spirituality in his deep beliefs, but I shouldn't think it...
But what about the belief in the curse that was put on him, or the supposed curse that was put on him?
Well,
I mean, what the background to that story, or did he invent it, or did it just make it?
No, he didn't invent it, but I think he capitalized it.
He wrote it up.
Right. Yeah,
it then got inflated and misunderstood and caused a lot of misunderstanding. Right. I think Douglas has put it right in his book, for the most part. Well, yes, there was one...
In perspective.
Yeah, there was one crucial thing which I think Gavin may not have been aware of, but was explained to me by Kathleen Rain, the poet who put the curse on the rowan tree by the house, was that I think the next year she came down secretly to the house, to the rowan tree, and put her hand on the rowan tree and said, I undo this curse. If that is the case, and if one believes in the efficacy of curses, then all the tragic events that happened in Gavin's life after that could not have been due to the curse. If you see what I mean.
Yeah.
That's right.
And, but to end the story, of course, now the round tree is dead.
Now the round tree is dead.
I think there are good horticultural reasons for that.
It's been dwarfed by the other tree.
But just undernourished. Just picking up Rafe's point, which I fully accept that Gavin himself had a half sceptical, not a totally sceptical view of paranormal.
Yeah.
But he was partly involved in it, partly intrigued by it, I think.
I think the strength of his, enormously strong character, I think we all agree. And he could transmit that character into other people's heads. And I could often detect the change in his mood, even when he was out of sight, some distance away. I mean, I remember being at home, and more than one occasion, having left him.
Come on, boys.
Left him in a very sort of happy and very tranquil mood. And when I've been at home, possibly for 2 or 3 hours, I've been aware that his mood's been deteriorating, and that's been confirmed by a telephone call at about that time, saying I'm in the depths of despair, Richard. Which was, I think, quite interesting. It's very marked. And I began to get very alarmed about it, because when I knew he was going to die, I didn't know what the moment of his death was going to do to me.
Mm-hmm.
In the event of the sleep. But I felt that it had become rather alarmingly possessed.
Gavin Maxwell wasn't a man that sought out publicity. But luckily, maybe a month or two before he died, Douglas Botting did some recordings for the biography that he's written. It was very strange to be sitting in that Croft house that Maxwell knew so well, listening to a voice that his friends hadn't heard for 25 years.
Dream of a simple life is a dream of life without responsibility. And I think that the vast majority of people believe this to be possible. I've never found it possible. You can't suddenly say to an animal, especially a wild animal, we are now going to move to London for the winter.
I wouldn't, if I just heard it by chance, I wouldn't have recognised it.
I wouldn't either, because it's missing the laughter, which was...
Right, and anything like this put him under such strain, didn't it, anything in
terms
of
public
appearance.
Yes,
he put on a...
There is a distinct lack of sparkle in his voice there, isn't there?
Yes, yes.
Very noticeable.
It also sounds deeper.
Yes, well maybe that's the whiskey.
Yes, I think it's
maybe that was... Lunch.
Maybe that was lunch. What would he have thought of today? Here you are, all his friends, gathered at the place which he regarded as his sole home. I would have thought he would have been rather pleased with his friends, but I don't think he would have been pleased. I think he would have been outraged with the natural history world and what we've done to it over the last 25 years.
Perfect.
He was a man who had great respect for the natural world. And over the last 25 years, we have... destroyed that natural world virtually, and a lot of people have not got any respect for it. There's a few that are fighting out there. I would have thought he would have been absolutely outraged with what's going on at the moment. This is so different from the last time you were here, when in fact you were at his funeral.
Very moving occasion. Just sort of apt. Good weather. The weather was right for him. Everything was right. It was a very moving occasion indeed.
The odd thing was that I think it was barely more than a week after Gavin was laid to rest, there was still one survivor of the Ring of Bright Water saga, which was Tekko the Otter.
Yes.
Living on by himself virtually on Kailakin. And people were wondering, you know, what's going to become of this last vestige of the saga. And amazingly, within a week, I guess it was a week of Gavin being buried, Tekko was found drowned in the pool. And the keeper who was assisting running the sort of zoo park on Kailakin Island explained in a letter to me that he had gone up to the top of the island one night when it was an amazing night of stars and prayed that Gavin would take Tekko. I mean, it sounds very far-fetched, but that's what he said. And was sort of gratified that in fact Tekko died and wrapped up the whole thing. Everything had gone, the house,
yes,
Gavin, the otters.
I'd been away for quite some time and I'd come back to camp on the islands, and the bulldozers came down the track
and started bulldozing the remains of the house. And it was actually on that day that Gavin died. But it was rather sad to see a house that you'd lived in and obviously had many happy times in being bulldozed and buried into the ground, because it was really the end when that happened.
Mm-hmm.
I'm often questioned about Gavin Maxwell, and indeed Camus Fearn and Ring of Bright Water, and the otters, and people are absolutely fascinated by
it. What do you think they take away with them? Apart from the pebbles, maybe.
Mm. I think they take away a sort of take away a dream, really, of really what they would like to, how they would like to live their lives. But whether or not they could cope with it if they did live here for any length of time is a different story. It's a romantic fantasy for most people, but that doesn't do them any harm.
He was not only a tremendously stimulating company and somebody you could converse with about anything under the sun and get a sympathetic hearing, but he was also an enormous encourager of the young. I was still a student. I was an aspiring writer. I showed him something I'd written, and a note came back very, very quickly saying, I think the words were, "Let me say that you'd be wasting your time doing anything else." And gave me enormous encouragement at everything that I did, whether it was traveling or writing. And I think this was a common experience of everybody that met him. So he was a very positive and a very generous person. And I think, looking back, one has to be grateful that one had the privilege of knowing him.